Hello and welcome. It is a privilege to us that we have here with us Mr. Dinesh Patnaik, Director General of Indian Council for Cultural Relations, more popularly known as ICCR. A career diplomat of Indian Foreign Service, he has served in the Indian missions in Geneva, Dhaka, Beijing and Vienna. From India, he has handled Europe-based external publicity, Africa and UN divisions. He has served as Deputy Chief of Mission in Vienna. He has been Ambassador to Cambodia, Morocco, and Deputy High Commissioner of India to London, besides occupying various other positions. Welcome, Mr. Patnaik.
Thank you very much.
It is a privilege. Before starting the interview, it is said generally that culture is the very essence of life. It distinguishes between existing and the living. Would you like to elaborate on this?
No, this is what I've been saying since the last few months, that what culture does is differentiates between existing and living. And during this time of COVID, we have really come to understand what it means to exist and what it means to live. When you stay at your home without anything, if you didn't have culture, you'd just exist. And you'd not really know what is life about. What distinguishes us from other people, especially from the animal kingdom and from the rest of the world, is the culture that we have. Because culture defines who we are. And it also defines who we want to be. Because culture gives us an impression of where we want to reach, what we are, what we want to be. So in that sense, culture permeates every part of a human existence. Without culture, we are nothing. And culture becomes more important when we share it with other people, when there's a diversity in culture. Culture actually dies when it becomes stagnant. It becomes better when it is shared, when there is more diversity, when there is more efflorescence, when we do much more together. So the whole idea of ICCR has been to share cultures, to share Indian culture with other countries and bring the cultures of other countries into India. Like Rabindranath Tagore used to say, you have to open the windows of your world to the winds of other countries. And that's the only way when we become active and when we become big. And India has always been like that. India has been open to the world. And we have had linkages with all parts of the world. And even today, our foreign policy, the policy of the government of India, is to be open to everybody and to share our experiences, share our culture, share our legacy, share our heritage. And that is what we are doing in ICCR.
You said that the idea of ICCR is to share the culture with other countries. It has been 70 years now. ICCR has a very long legacy. And if I remember correctly, it was Maulana Abul Kalam Azad who inaugurated it in 1950, perhaps.
50.
Yeah. So, can you briefly explain the aims and objectives behind ICCR?
See, the whole idea is to, today ICCR, see what it started with was different. It started mostly as academic and cultural cooperation, which means that you do scholarships, you do students, you exchange conferences, seminars, and you send performing art troops from each country to other. So that was the initial idea of what ICCR would be. To have increased mutual understanding between countries so that people understand each other's culture. When they understand each other's cultures, they understand each other better. So that was the whole idea. Today it has evolved into something much more because it has become the main cultural diplomacy arm of the Ministry of External Affairs. And for the government of India, it is the soft power diplomacy, which is very important because today's world does not rely on hard power like in the past. Today depends on soft power, the ability to influence others, to understand you, to be able to do things the way you want, to be able to cohabit with you and to make systems together. That is the ultimate power of soft power.
70th anniversary of ICCR fell on April the 9th, and then it was followed by World Culture Day on 21st May, and both of them fell in the lockdown period. In fact, otherwise you would have gone for a gala celebration. How did these events went ahead despite lockdown?
See, we did not anticipate that this COVID situation will arise. So we had planned for a very big celebration on Foundation Day. We had planned for a big celebration on Cultural Diversity Day, which actually we have a new lecture series called the Deen Dayal Upadhyaya Memorial Oration Series. So instead of celebrating just cultural diversity, we also have a lecture by important personalities. And also now the International Day of Yoga coming this month. So all these we had prepared to do it in a very big way because these are today very important events that ICCR holds every year and it has become important. Everybody waits for it also. Unfortunately, when COVID happened, we did not know what to do in the beginning. Then we realized that the world is going online, we have to also go online. So on, before that, what we did is we realized that ICCR has to start its activity in a manner in which uses the latest technology to reach out to people even when they're sitting at home. So we started the Global Art Competition, which was an art competition asking people to express their feelings through art during a time of COVID. And it was a huge success worldwide. We got more than 8,000 plus top class entries. And you know, 8,000 entries just to look at that takes a long, long time. Even if you take 2 minutes per entry, it's 16,000 minutes, which is a huge amount of time. And but we did that. We had a essay competition on Foundation Day, which was very, very huge amount of entries came in. We have online performances going on, online yoga, online music, online dance. We also are having a large number of lecture series on Deen Dayal Upadhyay. Because this is time of COVID, we decided in the first one, Sushma Swaraj ji had spoken about soft power, Justice Lahoti had spoken about in the second one, and in the third one we decided that let's tackle the question of how can traditional medicine systems help in COVID. So we looked at Ayush and Ayurveda. So we got one of the top professors and practitioners, Dr. Morandi from Italy, to speak, and we had a panel which could discuss it. And this was telecast all over. We reached out to thousands of people. We also celebrated World Cultural Diversity Day by doing poetry contests, by doing poetry online poetry discussions, online book discussions, online exhibitions. So in a sense, ICCR has gone online in a very big way, because that's the only way. Today, when social distancing has become important, when people cannot meet each other, when you're going to go into, do not want to go into crowds, you have to reach people in their homes. And we are doing that. The technology is available. People are getting adjusted to it. In fact, it's become so much that people are now even doing normal meetings on online rather than meeting together. So ICCR has managed to evolve itself to go. Now we are planning for the next stage of really going into a very high level, where we create our own platform, where we start creating our own devices, and that we are planning, and hopefully in the next few months you will see it happening.
Now this COVID-19, now it is apparent it's a long evolving process and we have to get used to it. What is the future of culture and creative sectors in this scenario which has emerged now already?
See, there are two parts to it. You are asking what is the future of culture and what is the future of ICCR. So I'm going to distinguish between both of them. See, culture and creativity, usually in times of stress and tension and pandemics and disaster, actually becomes more stronger. If you look at it in the world over, some of the best pieces of work of art, I mean, Albert Camus wrote The Plague, Milton wrote Paradise Lost during his own problems when he had. We had some of Picasso's Guernica was drawn during these times. So, you know, always situations of trouble and stress gives rise to creativity, because the whole reason is creativity gives meaning to life. When people feel helpless, they need some meaning in life, so they resort to creativity, because that makes them not feel helpless, that makes them feel that they're still alive and still strong enough to combat this. So in a sense, creativity gets efflorescence during a time of crisis, and I'm 100% sure you will have a large number of books been written, many new music being composed, new art forms coming out, huge amount of creativity would explode in the world during this time.
And you have news to reach to a wider audience.
Yes. So not only that, it brings out the creativity in people, because that's the only way we justify when we face our own mortality.
True.
When we see that we can die at any time, we realize the only way to face death is to be creative yourself. And that is what happens. So that will happen. So that is the future of culture. I'm very positive about it. Culture, there will be an efflorescence of cultural creativity. But when we look at culture manifestations, then for some time we will have to go online, because people will not like to gather together. So large festivals, music festivals, dance festivals, all these will have to be done in a slightly more subdued manner. This will happen for some time. You have to understand, we have lived with pandemics all our life. We lived with smallpox for 3,000 years. We have lived with all kinds of other diseases. We will also live with this. Humankind is very resilient. It's something which will arise and do well. So So I'm very positive that it will happen. But for the time being, we have to take precautions, because in today's world, there is a lot at stake. It is not just human lives, but whole systems at stake. So we'll have to take it precautionary forever, but it will evolve. And I'm confident that it will all come back to normal and we will emerge stronger with a much more efflorescence of cultural creativity. You see, when we moved from the non-movies system to movies, then when TV came in, when technology made spectacles very large, things change every time. Now with this new COVID, we are moving into a new realm of online entertainment, where OTT platforms and everybody wanting to see culture at their own leisure. Earlier, to see culture, you had to go at a particular time, particular place. Now you can sit back and decide that 9 o'clock in the evening, I want to see some culture, 11 o'clock in the morning, while before going to sleep. So the whole paradigm is changing. So culture goes into the house easily. It's a vehicle that people can use to reach each other. So it is a very exciting.
Only difference is that earlier changes were gradual, this had come all of a sudden and stopped.
So it always happens like that. No, it's never gradual. Even those when it came, people thought it was coming too fast. Every time the change comes, there are people who oppose it and people look. But here there was no time for people to oppose it. You had to accept. So in a way it is much better, this change.
So now that you are saying that 2 months time there are more things on the anvil, are we going to reach out to the public at large for their overall mental health and well-being? Because all over India there are people who are suffering at the moment.
See, we'll have to reach out. It is not ICCR's mandate to look at this. Our mandate is to develop cultural relations with countries around the world. But we'll have to do it, and we'll have to play one part of the role in it. Because, like you said, if you have to look at the mental well-being and health of people, then one of the few things is the whole aspect of culture. Culture means from movies to music to dance to entertainment to everything. People will have to feel relaxed. People will have to feel not stressed by this factor. Fear has entered into people's mind. There is a lot of stress everywhere, psychological problems. All this will have to be handled. And culture is one of the ways in which we can address it. But there are other ways also we will have to do it. It is not ICCR's mandate, but we are sure that we will also be playing a role.
Cross country means if you are organizing events on a big
scale. We will be organizing event, but that is to bring together people of both countries, to show similarities between countries. Yeah. But to address things like mental well-being and health, they will need our cultural content. But we will not be in the front line.
But the economies are all down, in fact, all over the world. Now, culture and cultural heritage, how much it can play a part in reviving the economies?
You see, if you look at the British economy today, there was a study done. The creative industries, when you look at the creative industries, were almost 50% of the economic activity of that country. Similarly here, because creative industries encompass everything from tourism to culture to performing arts to artisans to people who do, handwork, handicrafts. You name it, creative industries, movies, theatres, TV serials, this entire industry is one of the largest employers, one of the strongest workforce, or the most creative people. But yet, it is not an organized sector in India. Because it is not an organized sector, the people have to depend on themselves, on somebody else to hold functions. And during the time of COVID, when everything has come to a standstill, these artists and artisans are the ones who will suffer the most, because they don't have a structured, organized system to fall back upon. So the revival also will depend on them. But because people will have less money, culture has always done well in a time of prosperity. When the kings are there, the emperors are there, when country is prosperous, culture becomes very. So it is a chicken and egg issue. Culture will help in reviving the economy, but a revival economy will help more in culture growing. So both have to go hand in hand. The government also has to look at the cultural industry to see that it is an intrinsic part. It is, because culture is both entertainment as well as economics. Because it contributes to a large extent to the economy of the country.
You mentioned about England. Now in Europe, they have started talking of culture as a developmental driver. You have already mentioned a bit of it. Now, do you think government of countries like India, where there are so many problems, so many miseries on the road, we can see, they will have budgets for all this knowledge.
No, the reason you talk of budgets is because you think government is the only driver of culture. That's the reason you talk of budget. It is not true. Culture is to be done by everybody. Government has to only facilitate. The huge cultural heritage and legacy and the millions of people who are working as artisans, artists, are not supported by government. They're supported by individual people, by cities, by towns, by cultural organizations, by NGOs, by everybody. It's a huge thing that is happening. Government is a very small part of it, but government is a crucial part because it sets the framework for all this to happen. So budget, that's the reason, is not very important. There will always be budget. It is the ability to create the framework in such a way that all these artists and artisans find an avenue to perform and earn. Because at the end of the day, they do it for earning, to make a living. There are only few who do it for out of pure love of the arts, but most people, it's their livelihood. So government is setting up a system in which we shall ensure that they get livelihoods, at the same time be able to contribute to society.
What opportunities do you see will rebound after the crisis is over, like for this?
See, one is of course the whole online thing. That will be big opportunities, not directly for the cultural people, but for everybody else. For example, let's start with the artisans. The artisans will now have to use online platform to reach out to consumers for designs, for new ways of doing things. So there has to be now connectivity happening. It's already happening. There are e-commerce people, the people who are doing it, galleries online. So that is artisans. So artisans will benefit from having now more access online to be able to reach markets very, very far away. Now an artisan in Lucknow could only look at around himself in his own area. But now an artisan from Lucknow can sell from anywhere, from Chennai, Tiruvantapuram to the US, to Brazil, anywhere. So the whole online thing will help an artisan to reach much more, because now he realizes more than before that this is his way of earning money. Same with artists. The artist who used to look at performing only for small places can now perform for a much larger audience. If he or she is good, a much larger audience will be able to see it. So these are the advantages that will come of coming online. Now within the system, we will have to find innovative ways of how to do culture. Earlier you used to have a gathering of 1,000 people seeing and watching, who will pay tickets and come. Now for getting 1,000 people is going to be difficult. So if you're doing social distancing, you'll get about 200 people. Ticket prices will have to increase, or if they remain the same, people will get less money. So all these things will have to be worked out. It is too early to say which sectors will flourish more and which sectors will do more. But I'm confident going online has a great advantage of reaching a much wider audience than doing offline.
Last question, a bit on the personal side. Working as a career diplomat and working in a cross-country environment, you are used to, culture is of course there, but then you are used to more political gimmicks and so many things, basically bilateral relations and so on. What kind of a transformation has it been for you coming directly here in this organization where you just have to talk about culture?
Technically, it is also the same political work we are doing here. We are not doing culture, pure culture. We are culture managers. Like any other diplomacy you do, diplomacy is basically bringing people together. So you have a political diplomacy, you have a economic diplomacy, you have a cultural diplomacy, you have a soft power diplomacy, you have various other kinds of diplomacy. This is another version of diplomacy. The tools are different, but the end result is the same. So I use cultural tools to reach the same goal as somebody uses political tools to reach the same goal. The goal ultimately is for India to be recognized by its friends and nations across the world that we are a power of good, and what we are doing for the world benefits the world. That when India comes forward and does things, it is for benefit of the world. And we do that by showing people that we have this cultural heritage, this cultural legacy, that India does, shares what it has and wants to share what it has with the rest of the world. So this is the kind of messaging we have. So in a way, nothing much changes, because we are ultimately practitioners of diplomacy. It is only different tools that we use. And sometimes I believe the cultural tool is much more powerful
and longer-lasting
than other tools.
Tools are different, but the end result is the same. Thank you so much, Mr. Patnaik, for giving us the time.